you know, we need to confirm, obviously, if somebody's going to choose active surveillance, that it is 3+4. So do you suggest that they get another targeted biopsy and confirm, that they get a second reading with someone like Dr. Epstein from Johns Hopkins? What is that process like?
That's right. You have to vet the situation. And one popular thing is to order a genetic test in a situation like this, Oncotype or Prolaris, and that will provide an actual number. Oncotype will tell you, what's the percent likelihood of your particular genre of prostate cancer spreading within the next 10 years, spreading outside the prostate? That's the defining issue with all cancers, including prostate cancer. The ones that stay home in the prostate are harmless. If we could be 100% sure that they'll stay home in the prostate, then we wouldn't treat anybody. And that's, of course, the policy with a low risk. We know that 3+3 never spreads. And those gentlemen can safely pursue active surveillance. So genetic testing would be a start. And then making sure that something is not being missed. The initial biopsy may look very favorable, but if you get a multiparametric MRI, if you do another biopsy, or if you have the pathology checked by Dr. Epstein, as you mentioned, sometimes things won't turn out quite as rosy as you initially thought, and you'll have to rethink, is it really safe to do active surveillance?
So if low-teal is active surveillance, what is basic-teal? I know for monotherapy, but what would monotherapy look like for a patient?
So we tend to lean towards some form of radiation. There are a number of things that can be done, surgery, radiation, HIFU, laser treatments. But if someone is resigned to the fact that there's going to be a risk of erectile dysfunction, some form of whole prostate treatment is the usual approach with teal, seed implant radiation, proton radiation, SBRT, IMRT are all perfectly fine. And depending on an individual's age and pre-functioning sexual status, you know, there's going to be anywhere from a 1 out of 4 to a 1 out of 2, 50% risk of erectile dysfunction as a result. There is another layer of complexity to bring into here. Some men have unilateral disease after careful vetting and can consider doing focal therapy, focal radiation, focal laser, focal HIFU, and that reduces, doesn't eliminate, but it reduces the risk of getting erectile dysfunction. The disadvantage with focal therapies are finding someone who's really skilled at doing it. And then since some of the prostate remains untreated, those men will need active surveillance for the rest of their lives because they could still catch a new cancer in the untreated portion of their gland.
So for people in the, you know, let's say basic to high teal categories, what does the imaging process look like? And, you know, are you automatically going to send them to an MRI or a PSMA scan in order to confirm this before you decide on a treatment regimen?
Definitely a multiparametric MRI before making any final decisions. PSMA PET scans have been FDA approved. They're going to be broadly available probably in the next 3 to 6 months. Someone with basic teal, you could, if you're trying to confirm that the cancer is on one side of the prostate, a PSMA PET scan could be very useful for that. We don't think that the risk of spread outside the gland is very high, so you don't need to uniformly or universally do PSMA PET scans in someone with basic teal, but if you're thinking of focal therapy, maybe yes. Those that have high teal, PSMA PET scans are useful to confirm that there's no early metastatic disease in the pelvic lymph nodes.
Yeah, that's one question I get quite often on Helpline is, you know, they may have gotten that they're a 4+3 and they're figuring out if they're, you know, between basic and high teal, but then they see seminal vesicle invasion and they're like, okay, does that put me in another category and what do I do then?
So seminal vesicle invasion or lymph node invasion would be an azure or a high risk situation. Traditionally, we've thought of those people needing 18 months of hormone therapy plus radiation to the prostate.
So what does a conversation look like for somebody in the basic to high teal range for you? I mean, is it really just prioritizing quality of life? Because I think a lot of people, when they get diagnosed with prostate cancer and then they realize it's not something that they can monitor, they get into kind of a flight or fight mode and they want to make a treatment decision immediately. And obviously, this sounds like it's quite a process.
Yeah, it's a mistake to go rushing into treatment before you really know what you're doing. The quality of life still remains an issue. There's a lot of flexibility now with the advent of these new PSMA PET scans. Historically, we had to take extra precautions because there could be early spread into the lymph nodes, and that necessitated radiation of the lymph nodes sometimes and 6 months of hormone therapy. The experts don't really know how much we can back off of that when people have a PSMA PET scan that shows no spread. There's not a 100% certainty that there's no spread when you have a clear scan, but it's much, much lower risk. And taking hormones for 6 months is not a small undertaking. So someone may be older or younger. All these factors are weighed in the process of deciding how aggressive treatment should be.
So what is the monitoring process for somebody who's going into short-term hormone therapy? Maybe the PSA is being lowered. What do they need to look for in order to make sure that they're maintaining that disease control?
Well, almost everybody responds to treatment initially. So we're not wondering if treatment will work. Practically everyone goes into a remission with hormones or radiation or both. So it's more an issue of what do you do afterwards. Once you stop treatment, you want to check testosterone levels, make sure that that's recovering, and of course, watch PSA levels. And we probably should do another video about what we call the PSA bump or monitoring PSA after treatment, because it can be a little confusing. PSA recovery, when testosterone comes back, the prostate will still make a little bit of PSA, and so there are variables. But the whole idea, of course, is if the PSA remains low and stable, you don't have too much to worry about.
Have you had patients where they've gone into permanent remission being a teal case?
The cure rates are very high. If you look at cure rates for basic teal, it's over 90%. For high teal, probably in the 80-85% range, or perhaps even a little better than that. Yeah, people are sometimes confused by using the word cure. They always say, well, it could always come back. No, that's not really true. You get about 5 years out, 4 or 5 years out after radiation. If the PSA is low and stable, that person is essentially cured.
Hi everyone, it's Alex and Hunter. Hunter's our official PCRI mascot. If you'd like to learn more about men's health tips and prostate cancer, you can follow him on Instagram, Sir Hunter the Dal. And also subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week. Say bye!